Why don't we go ahead and get started? I want to try to maintain some semblance of time control here so we can get people out as early as we possibly can. For those of you that don't know me, my name is Bill Scavarla. Unfortunately, you probably already know me, but anyways, it's just Bill. And I wanted to thank you all, first of all, for coming. And I wanted to explain a couple things, what's different about tonight, what the agenda is going to be like today. And then I wanted to start with a prayer. Nancy is not here. Nancy McCarthy usually does a little prayer before each one of these. So I'm going to step in as best as I possibly can, and she probably won't be proud of me, but I'm going to do it anyways. So if we could just have a moment of silence, and I am going to say, Dear Lord, please watch over those of us in Claremont County. Amen. That's the best I can do. Why are we here? There are some interesting changes that have occurred over the last few weeks since we met at the high school. There is significant damage being done in the properties as a collateral effect of them getting into these woodlots and essentially being in conditions where, to be honest with you, they don't have much control over. They could not have picked Young's General Contracting, the USDA, and the ODA could not have possibly picked a worse winter to try to come into Tate Township and do work on these trees. It's just everything's working against them. We've not only had one of the warmest winters, but we've also had one of the wettest winters. Now, that combination on top of these Claremont soils, as you all, as property owners know, is a, I mean, it's a disaster. So what we need to do as property owners is we need to start protecting ourselves legally. We have come up with a process to help you do that. And we'll outline that today. This meeting tonight is going to be a little bit different than ones we've had in the past. Rather than being all about legal or all about donations or all about environmental, we are going to break it out into what's called breakout sessions. So you're only going to hear from me probably about 15 minutes. I do have a few things that I need to cover. And then at that point, if you have an interest in the legal side of it, you will be sent to one area. If you have an interest in the damage report side of it, you will stay up here in the front where there will be a PowerPoint presentation and a little video. If you are interested in how can I help, there are tables set up in the back for contributions. If you are interested in the environmental assessment, Paul Barbic will also be in the back with Michael McCarthy. Well, he's up here now, but he will be back there. And and I will be available to answer. I'm going to take Nancy's place again and kind of do ALB 101. But I only wanted to offer that up for people that really have no idea about what this beetle is, okay? We decided that at this stage of the game, if you're not aware of what's been going on in Tate Township, you've pretty much been under a rock. So rather than spend a half an hour on it's a black beetle with white spots, we are going to save that time for anybody who really doesn't have a general idea what the beetle is about. They can talk to me at a private breakout session. Okay? All right. Let me just check my notes here. The coverage area of the ALB is expanding exponentially, not only within the core zone of where the beetle first was found, which is my neighborhood, but now, as many of you already know, and Travis is here to represent the village, thank you for coming. As those of you that live in the village already know, this thing has spread into Easter and Fossil and McMurtry and East Street and North Main. It's getting into the heart of the village. They've already taken out three trees in Burke Park. Fortunately, that's the only one scheduled at this time to come down. So that's a good sign. So that's the second reason why we're getting together tonight, is because of the fact that this thing is growing exponentially. The damage update, essentially what they are saying number-wise, there are 4,684 infested trees. There are 6,000, I'm sorry, there's been 4,684 removed. There are 6,740 that are infested. Now that's out of a total of almost 91,000 trees that we are essentially fighting for. Of those 91,000 trees, we're fighting for 84,000 of those trees. Those are the trees that are not infested, but that the USDA and the ODA wants to come in and take down anyways. That's what our organization is all about. That's what the Bethel ALB Cooperative is all about. We need your help. We'll talk about how you can help later on. Next. I have Cor and Dirk Smits are up here. They're also going to be available to talk about the damage that they're going to share with you, the experience that they had on their own property over there on State Route 232, directly across from where the marshalling yard is, or Taylor's old place. They have a video. Dirk has made a video documentary of things that occurred on his property. Dirk has actually taken a lot of the information from his own place and developed that into a system for reporting property damage that will be so that we'll all be able to protect ourselves from damage after it occurs. As far as protecting yourself before it occurs, you know, we have said from the very beginning, it's extremely important that you document. We've pleaded with people from the very first time that we met at the winery over there. You need to document. Document the trees, take pictures of the trees, take diameters of the trees. You need everything to be documented on your property before they even start. I guarantee you that 90% of the people have not done that. So, when I'm asking you again, I'm pleading with you again, in order to protect yourselves, if it isn't written down, if it isn't documented, the damage wasn't done, okay? You need to do before and after. If you have areas on your property that you're concerned about, if you have a leach field in your backyard and you don't want them running a track hoe on it, you need to be able to warn them ahead of time. You need to be able to document what that leach field looked like before they got started, if they're going through your backyard to take trees out. You need to document what it looked like before they got started, and then you need to document what it looked like after they were done. And if they disrespected your property and went over top of those leach lines, then you have a right to follow up with some kind of a recourse. Either you get a plumber out there and he dictates that there was no damage done to your leach field or whatever. But my point is, please, you have to document. If it's like in healthcare, and If you don't write it down, you never did it. So it's the same thing with this documentation process. Okay? A little bit of housekeeping. We have two sign-up sheets back there. I will tell you that this core team of volunteers, myself and the seven total core team members, you can't imagine the work that we've done over the last few months. I've talked about that. I talked about that at the high school. Now it's getting to the point where this thing is expanding out. Now, we plead with people to volunteer to help us distribute door to door, help us pick up some of our printing costs. Anything that you all can do is helpful. The problem is we're not getting much assistance from the general public. So here is what I'm asking. There are two sign-up sheets back there. If you have not signed up yet, if you have email access, please sign up on the sheet that says name, email address. If you do not have computer access and you have to depend on us to come to your door with a handout for the meeting or a handout for a damage report, then sign up on the other sheet that basically says name, street address. Okay? That way, as opposed to, we went out just this past week and we distributed over 200 flyers door to door. I mean, many of you, how many received them at your door? Okay, so you see many, many people. We can't afford to do that anymore. We don't have the manpower, number one. Number two, as I said earlier, this thing is expanding exponentially. So it was one thing when it was concentrated on our hilltop over there by the winery, but now that it keeps getting larger and larger and larger, we need to kind of update our process for keeping all of the property owners involved and aware of what's going on. Do you understand? Okay, so from this point on, if you have email access, anything that's an invitation to a meeting or anything that is a handout of any kind, say for the property damage, what we will do then is we will send it to you as an email attachment, okay? The only people that will be getting non-email attachments, of course, are the, that makes sense. The people that don't have computer access, guess what? They're not getting any. Okay, there is another delay in the environmental assessment. For those of you that have been following the environmental assessment, the EA, the environmental assessment, is being done by the U.S. Department of Agriculture. And essentially what they are doing is they have been promising us since the beginning of November that this thing would be completed. They keep delaying, delaying, delaying over and over and over again. It was supposed to be out this Thursday. We just got word this morning that that will be delayed again now until the end of March. So with the environmental assessment, what the USDA intends to do is they intend to give themselves the okay to come in and take out the additional 50 to 100,000 non-infested healthy trees. So needless to say, everybody that has been following this has been on pins and needles, and they continue to keep just juggling us around on pins and needles. But I wish I had good news about the environmental assessment. I do not. We already talked about the current numbers. I told you what is going on as far as the number of infested trees. I told you that we are fighting for those 84,000 trees and will continue to do so as long as we have the support of the citizens of Bethel and Tate Township. This is something new. There was some options for those of you that are in there or were in the path of the tornado and have property damage as a result of the tornado. First of all, you have my blessings that things are recovered very quickly on your property. Next, I wanted to tell you that there is indeed a change in the way that wood is handled. So if you have any, if you live on a one of the areas that was hit by the tornado and you have woody debris or wood that needs to be disposed of, you need to check with me before you leave, because there is a lot of change in the way that's going to be handled. And it's too much detail to go into for everybody else who is not affected by that. Lastly, contributions. I never have an easy time asking for money, but I'm, by the same token, I'm not proud either. Here's the thing. We have decided, as this thing has expanded and gotten larger and larger, the amount of donations are actually, the amount of contributions are actually going down. The only reason that we've been able to protect those 84,000 trees is because we have had the money to keep funding our legal team and keep them in our pocket. Now, things are getting a little more difficult to maintain as far as the legal defense fund is concerned. Many of you I know have contributed, and for that I can't tell you how much I thank you. I was going to originally ask for a show of hands of the people that contributed, but I don't want to embarrass anybody. So what I am going to say instead is, after a long discussion with our attorney today, we're going to have to change the way we do things, because we need to be able to have the money to keep this thing going forward. If you are a property owner affected by the Asian longhorn beetle and you have not contributed anything to the legal defense fund, those phone calls to our attorney are going to stop, because they're no longer going to represent you if you haven't contributed to the legal defense fund. Now, I know to some of you that doesn't sound fair, but I'm finding more and more that what's happening is people are kind of riding the shirt tails or the coattails of those people. Somebody said to me just the other day, well, wait a second, you have your attorney. And it's like, no, it's not my attorney. It's your attorney. And it's your attorney, and it's your attorney, and it's your attorney. But it has to be, I mean, we all have to be show responsibility for keeping this thing alive. And in order to do that, unfortunately, it's taken money. So I would strongly, and we spent the whole week strongly suggesting that people consider making contributions. I would strongly, especially if you have not made a contribution yet to this point and you are in one of the affected properties, I'd strongly recommend that you consider doing differently, okay? $100 for property is what we're asking. If you can't do that, anything is acceptable. Anything is welcome. If you can't do it financially, geez, offer to walk door to door. Offer to print copies off for us so that we're not burning our own personal printers up at home to get stuff hand carried to your door. There has to be some semblance of responsibility, and I don't want to beat that dead horse anymore, but just please give that some consideration, okay?
Bill, can I say something?
Yes. You sure can.
Folks on the back, okay. In terms of, I mean, this community knows how to raise money for Boy Scouts, Cub Scouts, and stuff. We're also looking for ideas. So if it's bake sales, rummage sales, sell the scrap metal that's rotting in your holler, you know, whatever it may be, we're open to ideas to make something like that happen. Maybe you know the manager of Frisch's and we bus tables for tips all night long. So we're open to not only direct contributions, but ideas to raise money that you know will, you know, get people involved. And, you know, somebody who goes to Frisch's may not even be aware of the Beetle, but if we're, you know, bussing tables at night for tips, we can, you know, get that going to the fund. So we're open to ideas as well, too. So if you don't have a $1 million bank account to contribute to the fund, bring us ideas. We're not the be-all and end-all ideas. Thank you.
Thanks, Paul. For those of you that don't know, Paul, that's Paul Barbic. Paul's in charge of the environmental assessment team. He's in charge of, he's the guy and the committee that will address this EA if they ever come out with it. Just beginning to be doubtful at this point. We really don't understand, I mean, as an aside, we really don't understand why the delay, unless they are so nervous about making sure that all of their T's are crossed and their I's are dotted. They know how much scrutiny this environmental assessment is going to be under when it is finally released. So I think they're just terribly nervous about putting it out there in general public without making sure that every conceivable option has been, do you agree with that?
Yeah.
Yeah, that every conceivable option has been studied to the max because they know we're ready to jump on this thing with all 4 feet. 2 feet. Okay. Or four, yes. Or four. All right, so does anybody have any questions for me specifically at this point that I can address real quick? And then we're going to try to break this out a little bit into sessions. On the contribution table back here, I noticed that there is a sign-up sheet. We still have about 100 of those little trees like you see at the table. That we have about 100 of those left that if you want to get them, you can buy them. A percentage of the proceeds from that goes into the Legal Defense Fund. Danae, do we have any more t-shirts or did those not make it here? We do have some, there's still some t-shirts back there. Mine was dirty from the last time. What did I just do on, it was the park. I did the Burke Park thing and I had my white t-shirt on, so my white t-shirt was dirty. What else? I think that's about it. I would like to, did Dirk come?
Yeah.
Dirk is here. Hi, Dirk. I would like to introduce Cor Smits. Cor Smits is, his home is down around the corner from the winery, and most of you know where that's at. He is directly across from the marshalling yard, and Cor has been extremely, extremely helpful as one of our committee members. He actually works on the Environmental Assessment Committee, but he is just like the master statistician, so he has come up with some figures and some numbers that we will use in our defense when the time is right to try to stop the, or not try to stop the U.S. government from taking down the healthy trees. And keep that in mind. For those of you that are still thinking you need to really make a fuss and you really need to make trouble in your neighborhood or on your property, please, those infested trees need to come down. The quicker they come down, the better off it is for all of us. So if you're standing at the end of your property and you're saying, you are not coming on my farm to cut my maple trees down, You're hurting us in the long run. You're hurting yourself, and you're hurting your neighbors in the long run. So please keep that in mind. This whole group, the Bethel ALB Cooperative, is about saving the healthy trees, not the ones that are already eaten up with the beetles. And unfortunately, I found out today, one egg site that mandates that that tree indeed is infested. So if there's one egg site in it, that tree has to come down. But we're not fighting against the infested. We're only trying to save the non-infested, and that's an enormous amount, enormous number of trees. Okay, so Core is going to talk about owner rights as they relate to the to Young's own contract. Core Smith.
Thank you, Bill. First of all, I apologize for my accent. And maybe we can run a lottery. If you find out what my accent is originating, I will donate $25 to the ALB Fund. Except the people who knows it. My neighbors know, I exclude them. First of all, I want to ask you a question. On the ALB website, there is a contract shown, the Young contract with the USDA. Please raise your hand when you read it. Wow. Yeah, a number of them.
Granted, not all of it. There's a lot of it.
There is a lot of it. And I agree. It's a big, big reading. That's the reason, that's what I did. I started reading the contract, and my experience with government contracts is always to make a distinct difference on what it say and what it doesn't say. And basically, what I did, I took out of that contract that is important for property owners. Because removing trees means always damage. And it's a matter of to what degree. And what are your rights? And I was a little bit surprised going through it that there is a lot of things you as property owners can demand that Jung complies with the contract. Now in that contract is a weak spot for the property owners. In the contract is written that Jung has to report the damage. Now, that's the same thing as making a law that all thieves in the United States have to report to the police office. Yeah? Basically the same thing. So basically, it comes down to you as property owners have to defend your property. You as property owners have to make a report showing the damage. That's what I did with my son. I did a little bit more. He made a lot of pictures and movies when they were removing trees. The damage was horrible that they created and totally unnecessary. Because they hired loggers instead of landscapers. And the loggers just hew down trees and move them out fast. And the damage, because they're all subcontractors, the damage is for you. And if you don't respond, the damage is for you. And you will never make a report that damage is done. So I will walk you through this PowerPoint presentation and give you an idea what your rights are and what you can do. First of all, the red area is where most of the trees, maybe a few left, are removed. That's where most property owners have seen the damage. Currently, they are moving out a little north of the 232. So they are moving out now in more or less that area. And they have moved out in the Bethel village. When they can remove trees from a street side, the damage is limited. If they have to go on properties over a longer distance, the damage is large. So, Trees are mostly removed in this area. Now, there is a in the contract, a paragraph that says removing trees. And that is running under a strange heading, Public Relations Section 2.5. And it tells us that all personnel must be courteous, and work shall be completed without inconvenience or disruption of the general public and property owners. That means when they park vehicles on your driveway without a chauffeur being present to go out, you can stop them. That's what I did, and I threatened them to get a sheriff involved. Because they are not allowed to do that. They violate the contract even when they are removing trees. The contractor shall perform all work with due care, taking cautions against injury to all persons, animals, or property. And the contractor shall make every effort to minimize interference with vehicular and pedestrian traffic. And now the bold area. That's important. The contractor shall protect against damage to any existing, and listen, trees. So if there is a tree that is not in the area where they are removing trees, so collateral damage, that means they have to remove things to get access to the tree. Now, in the contract is also written that a contractor should start by taking the top of the tree down, then the limbs, and then fell the tree. What did they do on your property? Yeah, they cut them at the bottom. That's much more quicker and cheaper, because Jung is in there for making a profit. Yeah? So then the collateral damage goes much bigger. So the next time and the next round they come again for removing trees, watch them and tell them that they have to comply with the contract. On my property, more than 80 trees were removed. Only one was taken down the way it should be. The next time, I don't give them a pass. And why is that written in there? And there's a very good reason. When I inspected after the removal of the trees, we found pieces of branches around 2 to 3 inch thick, sticking around 20 feet in the soil, and gas when we got it out. Exit holes and egg nests. So now, instead of eradicating the beetle, you are start spreading the beetle. Because when that beetle comes out of that infested wood, what we'll do? We'll find a tree nearby as fast as it can. Yeah? So, be careful and take a look what they did. And the next time, make sure they do it in the right way. The contractor shall restore to the condition existing prior to the treatment operations of all areas of paving, lawns, walkways, sidewalks, fences, fixtures, etc. What is that etc.? That etc. is damage to trees that are not in the collateral area of trees removed. My property, there were around 8 or 9 trees heavily damaged. And the contractor is going to pay dearly for that. Yeah? I will go to the bottom for that. Then, they are saying that were damaged, dirtied, altered, or displaced by tree removal work. Another detail in the contract, I cannot put everything up here, is that before the end of the day, they have to clean up all dirt that is on your driveway and on your property. Did they do that? No way. So they violate the contract. Damage claims. There will be damage. The question is what damage and how much. The contractor shall supply on company letterhead an original of the release agreement signed by the injured party. So at the end of the whole thing, they will ask you to sign a release agreement. But if there is no damage reported, they don't have to ask anything. They just will move away. And all the mess they have created is yours. Yeah? Because they have to get these documents released and agreements signed by the property owners if the damage is reported, if there is a claim. If there is no claim, there is no damage. Now, interesting, who is going to make this claim? That's the stupidity in that contract. That claim should be provided to the USDA by the contractor. Yeah? So that is saying the same thing as the thief in the village has to report to the sheriff's office that he has stolen. Yeah? Same thing. It's stupid. So, even when there were damage claims, and I filed them, nothing happened. USDA did nothing about it.
Do you sign something before they start their work?
No.
You don't?
No.
They ask you to sign something when they're done?
No. No. The only thing they can ask you that you agree that the trees are removed, but they haven't done that on any property, but it's only a courtesy. There is nothing in the contract that say that a contractor has to do that. They have in time to give you a warning, and that is by phone 3 days and in written form 7 days prior when they start. Now it would be wise before they start removing trees to talk with the team and bring to their attention your demands and the way you want to have them done. And that doesn't mean they're going to follow it up. Yeah? But at least you have some input at that moment that there are things they have to consider. So when you have lead lines, you can tell them, don't go there. Yeah? If there is another area that is important, don't go there. They have to stay away from it. And even if they have to hand carry trees out, that's the way they have to do it. But if you give them a warning, and in best days to even do that in writing, and let them sign off that you have warned them. So you have to protect yourself, because the contract doesn't protect the property owner. They leave it up to the thief to report in that he has stolen. And the contractor has to file the report. So, if you never have received paperwork from Jung, the contractor, it really means there is no claim. Yeah? And finally, Jung will move out of this area, and you are sitting with the damage. It's yours.
Now, something I read, it says something at the end of the project. Is the project your property, or is the project the end of whenever they're done cutting all the trees down?
There are different interpretations for that, but there is a timeline. And there is a timeline, and it tells us that it's 2 weeks, and I will show that in one of the next. After the damage is reported, they have 2 weeks, or have to get an agreement from the property owner to go and deviate from that 2 weeks. There it is. All damage shall be repaired within 2 weeks or also time frame as agreed upon by the two parties. For some property owners, damage was repaired. Who here in the audience had reported a damage and got it repaired? You see, Jung is laughing. Anything you report goes to off from their bottom line. They have a certain amount of money for removing the trees, and they have in reserve a certain amount of money for what? For damage. And if you don't report damage, and I will go into that what damage is, and how you can basically report a lot of things where they don't comply with the contract, and then When they have to do all this extra work, they will lose big time money. So it's not their interest, it's your interest to report it. My estimate, the damage on my property done before they are finished, and they have done already a lot of work. It took them 3 times the time to start correcting the damage, and it's not completed. A local landscaper will complete it. It took them 3 times the time then removing the trees. My estimate is it will be between $25,000 and $40,000 damage for them. And I think they earn it. They should get it for the simple reason, the recklessness where they operate with. So, the contractor is not responsible for pre-existing conditions, and there is a big if. If contractor makes USDA aware of pre-existing damages prior to commencing activities at the work site. So the burden of proof that the damage was already there is with the contractor, not with you. He cannot say, hey, this damage was already done. He can have no way to get out of it. And Jung made a horrible mistake. They should have videoed every property before they started to have evidence. They did not on one single property. The crew went in and started just taking trees out. So never accept that you have to prove that they did the damage. The contractor should have reported that damage to the USDA before they started. Yeah?
Where are you located at?
232, you know,
you're on 232?
Yes, the plant from Taylor, and I'm straight across that plant on the top of the hill, the brick house.
Donnie, he's due east of you.
Yeah, okay.
Due east, if you would go straight across Taylor's from your backyard, you'd be in Core's driveway.
You know, it's that place where always, when you get a heavy rain, it's always fluted. That's what it is.
Driveway's fluted.
Yes.
You're on the right.
Yes. I'm on the right.
We're narrowing you down. I'm coming for supper.
Just watch for the flute.
Yeah. We are going now to restoration. Jung is responsible for executing the work to comply with section 333, that paragraph, site restoration. I made up a whole list what is important in the contract for Jung, and it's 4 pages, and I make advices what to do and where to look for, what is happening. Take them, read them, very important. Because you understand then what your rights are and then you can, where you can stand for. All restoration costs, realize that, will lower the profit margin for you. So if they have high restoration costs, their profit margin is going to shrink. And if we do a right job, I wish we could get them belly up. Yeah? So, he has no interest, and he tries to minimize the work to be done. The only one that can stop him to get away with that is you, as property owner, to stand on your rights and to get a job done right. If property owners are not alert or correct the restoration that is done wrong, it just will benefit you. So you can take maybe some shares in the company and get some money back from them. That's the only thing you can get. So, the damage to the landscape and property will end up at the end with you as property owner. Because there will be a time they say, you're coming now, you're half a year of a year late. Yeah? So be careful. What action can property owners take to get the restoration according paragraph 3.3 of the contract? We will walk you through that. You have to contact Jung, the major contractor. Read the guidelines and rights for property owners. It's a 4-page, and I think the hard copies are available and it will be coming on the ALB website. Survey your property. After the trees are removed, survey your property. See what they have done. And then, there are two ways of reporting. Property damage report, that's the simple version, that was put in your mailbox. Some people that have little damage or mainly a few things, they can use the simple version. If you have some wooded lots and a larger property, I recommend to use the property survey after tree removal form. It's a two-page, and step by step what is listed on that form is covered what's in the contract. So it's on, and it forces you to take the look at the issues that are important and that where you can demand correction and restoration and to get it done right. Then it's wise to write a letter covering your demand for restoration. It can be simple. You can simply say, here is my survey sheet and I want to have corrected all the things that are not yet done, and stick to your guns. Don't let things drift away. They might delay it, they might come up with all type of twists. Remember, Hume doesn't want to reduce his profit from the project. He is in there to make a profit. It's good, it's okay. But you have a right and they have to comply with that. Then, if you need help for writing a letter, Bethel ALB Citizens Cooperative can help you. You can make contact and then get it done. You send your report to Jung and a copy to sorry. I need some water. I'm losing my voice. So, Bethel ALB Cooperative like to see you reporting also to them. What are you going to look for? To see if there is tree damage done that are not in the collateral area of the trees. Typical when they move is the vehicle's material out, they jam in all type of things. That can be trees, that can be shrubs. They have, you can put it as a claim to treat the trees so they don't go down. And you can, for shrubs when they are damaged, they have to replace them. If they are not to be corrected, you can have to replace it. Look to lawn damage. They go with these big vehicles over your lawn, and what do? They make big ruts in your lawn, yeah? So what they try to do is move some dirt in, and then put some seed in, straw over it, and then over around 3 months you have ruts again, yeah? So, they have to treat this ruts in lawn, then put topsoil on it, 3 inches below, above the grade level. Yeah? Ruts and holes in wooded lots. When you have a wooded lot and they have moved in there with their vehicles, there are ruts in there. And when they move trees out, they leave a hole. Yeah? Now, in the wooded lots, most of the trees that they take out, the stumps will be taken out by stump grinding. Only the ones they cannot reach with a stump grinder, that's where they are going to use chemical treatment to kill the stump. So, when they have these ruts in your woods, and the ruts are so deep that they also make bare the roots of other trees. They have to bring in topsoil to repair it, because it's unnecessary damage has nothing to do with removing trees. They could have avoided that. And that's what they have agreed on. I had all these things on the list, and they have agreed on everything, and they are very, very pleasant at the moment. Very cooperative. Service routes in lawn and wooded areas. All service routes, according to the contract, have to be removed. And there are two important reasons that I come back on. Now, property owners, how many of you have seen service routes after removing of the tree? Yeah, it's a big concern. Why? When the trees rot, you will get ruts, and the albedo can hide in the roots. So if you report that, they have to come back in. Grind them all out in your lawn, grind them all out in the fields, in the woodlots, and then repair again. So why not reporting it? Because they have to correct it, and they have to do it right. You do the USDA a pleasure with that, because they want to have them removed. The reason is, it's a danger for spreading hope. Yeah? Then, use the property survey after the trees are removed. You really have to do that to get a better idea how big the damage is. Here you see a picture, and in the video you will see more of that. On the left side is the lawn prior to the tree removal. And on the right side here of you, you see how they plow the area. Sorry, guys. You removed all the topsoil. You have to bring all the topsoil back because you cannot seed on clay any grass. It will all die. So they took the topsoil out, and it was spread all over the place, and they dumped a part of it in the creek, but all the topsoil is gone, so they have to bring topsoil back. Damage estimate $12,000. Yeah? I will get these guys. So they had done restoration. Yeah. Now the rats were still there, and they had done seeding. You see that straw laying there? That was the moment I sent them off my property. I said I want to have professionals and not loggers doing my restoration. Yeah? So, the grading. Note how bad a job they have done. Yeah? So, you can refuse when they do a bad job. You can get them back and say, better do it right. Yeah, they have to satisfy you and bring the property back to the original condition before they started. And that is without ruts and a nice, smooth grading. Yeah? Aeration in heavy traffic compacted areas. They had in my property around 1,000 feet to travel with all these heavy vehicles close to trees, and they damaged the trees, but also all the topsoil was gone, and the soil was compacted around 2 to 3 inches. Sorry, guys, you have to put aeration so trees that are along that path would not die from soil compaction. You never thought about that, huh? But it's damage. It's damage. So, I had an arborist over, and he brought it up. And now I'm negotiating who's going to execute it, but the aeration will help. Will happen. Seeding grass and grass turf. There is an interesting thing in the contract. Both are options, and you make your choice. If they have damaged your lawn, you can say, I want to have grass sods in it and no grass seeds. Be careful. If you cannot water them over the summer, you cannot reach it, you better have grass seed. Yeah? But If you can water them, you're better off with grass sods. You have a choice there. Check if this topsoil has eroded. If they go in, and I went in the woods in my area, and a lot of area with the heavy rain we got with the tornado, a lot of topsoil was just washed away down the creek. Sorry guys, you have to replace that because you did the damage and now my topsoil is gone. There's no argument about it. They should have erosion protection in place within 2 weeks after they make the damage. Yeah? It's now 6 weeks ago. So they have to do that. Stump holes needs to be filled with topsoil 3 inches above grade. If it's in your lawn and then you move trees, and I have seen many places, it was flat to start with, and now you have a nice sinkhole where you can collect water, and in the summer you will have plenty of bugs around your home. So if you sit outside on your patio or on your porch, you need a lot of repellent to keep them off. Yeah? So what I'm saying, hey, the contract says when they remove a stump, they have to take the debris out and they have to fill the hole and raise the level with topsoil 3 inches above grade. Why? It will compact and then it will be level. After that, they do the seeding. If they have done the seeding on your property, you call them back. Let them do it right. Stay on your right. That's the key issue. And they have to. They have done it wrong, they have to correct it. Here you see some tree damage. They were totally out of the area where they were removing trees. They had a pathway to go out, and they hit the pine trees pretty bad because I had an agreement with Jung. They would cut all pieces to around 6 feet because we had around an 8 to 10 feet passage area and allowed them to go through. Guess what they tried? To get 16 feet through there. Didn't work. Yeah, didn't work. So, this is the result. I had an arborist in, and Jung has to pay for the arborist. And he made an analysis, and he said, yeah, these wounds, they have to be treated. You have to cut everything out here, that it is nice and smooth, and get it treated. And then basically, we went to the root system, and some roots were on the surface because all the topsoil was gone. You see, in Claremont County, there is a specific issue, and I learned that from arborists. The problem here is that you have a topsoil that is pretty good, but it's only 2 to 6 inches thick. Yeah? Now, the young comes in with his vehicle, way too wet weather, and pushes all the topsoil away. You are on the bare roots because the roots stay close to the top. They don't come in the depths where they can get their good stuff. No, they stay on the top. Therefore, you see so many surface roots from all the trees on your lawn. Yeah? They don't go in depth. Now, if you have a dry summer, you will see a lot of evergreens die for that same reason. Yeah? So, also, they were passing around 1 yard to 2 yards from that tree. So now they have to aerate the whole area there and approximately any place that can be shadowed by the canopy of the trees. Lots of money. And then put topsoil on it. Yeah? It's a nice example that a damage that is not listed, but it's a damage that shouldn't have occurred. Another damage, driveway. If you have a blacktop driveway, inspect the edges of the driveway. When they go on and up, they create damage. Yeah. Then sometimes they try to scrape the midst of the driveway. Result, you see it in the picture, nice grooves in your driveway. Yeah. They have to repair it. And if the damage is bad, you can demand resurfacing of your driveway. They have to cut all the dirt off. the driveway and have it cleaned up. And then they have to get, and I demanded a local company to do all the driveway repair and blacktopping again, or maybe resurfacing, depending on what comes out. When they really have pressure cleaned the driveway, we can see how deep the grooves are, because there is still mud in. There is another thing, if you have sides in the driveway that are cracked and the mud goes in, if you do a sealing, it doesn't help anymore, because the mud is in the cracks, yeah? And your driveway will be gone in 1 or 2 years. They will just break up. Erosion protection. You can demand erosion protection control measures in wooded lots with a slope or in a hill area. So if you have a slope in your property, you can demand erosion control. That means where all the tracks are, where the vehicles went through, they have to put measures in of erosion control. I demanded it, and it's even in the contract, a section that it has to follow a code that is written by the Ohio State University, and they have a code that tells you how to do it and what to do it. I demanded that a local landscaper would do it. They have agreed on that one as well. Demand that all holes in wooded area be filled to grade. I walked my property and looked to all areas where they took a tree out in the wooded lot. Around half of them, they did not refill the holes. They have to do that. I made a third round and found another two. They have to come back and fill them out. Bring them to level, keep them to the contract. Yeah, these people try to wiggle out and do the minimum work. Don't let that happen. Demand a local landscaper for erosion control. He has more experience and know-how of the area than anybody else you can find far away. And inspect if the work is executed according to the contract. So don't accept, say, hey, they have done it. Go out and see if it's done correct. It should. You should be happy with it. You should be able to approve it. Service routes. Here's a picture of my property. It was a big tree. And we found service routes 15 feet away from the trunk. They had to come back twice, because they did a second service route grinding. And then we found another bundle of them and had to come back the third time. And I demanded, take them out. Section 3.0, grinding of stumps, including service and buttress routes, to a depth of 6 to 8 inches below grade level. How do you check that? Oh, my son went out and I took and found pieces of the trunk that were, of the stump that were still around 2 inches below the grade level. So you put a scale in it, make a picture and send it in. Guys, do your job. Yeah? Why is that? These leftovers will rot and then you will get nice holes in your lawn. Yeah? And then the damage is later for you. Why do you need to remove all these service routes? And it's an embarrassment for the USDA and the ODA that all has happened, because they write it in the contract for a good reason. And the reason is they will die, rot, that's your problem, and your lawn will get ruts. But also, that's the USDA and the ODA concern, is that the beetle might live in the roots for some time and then come out and start infesting again. Yeah? So it's essential to take this surface root out. And it has to be removed. And that's what the contract is saying. So you don't ask for anything else, that they comply with the contract. tree stumps along the creek and other areas where they cannot come with a stump grinder, they use treatment. Now, in the contract, it's written the stumps need to be maximum 2 inches above grade if stump treatment is applied. If any are higher, demand that it cut up 2 inches. I have 16 stumps along the creek that had to be cut down. Some of them were around 24 inches high. So you didn't know what 2 inches were. They were thinking it were 2 feet. Yeah. So somebody at Jung can still calculate. Yeah. So they had some scientists there. So here is a picture of a stump, and that was the one that was 2 feet high, and the next one was also 2 feet high. Had to come back and cut them again. And if they do it the second time, you might go to the third time, but stick to your guns. It's your right to get it done. Why they want to have it cut away that high? The treatment, when the stump is too high, is only penetrating a certain depth. So then your tree stump is not going to die. Yeah? And it's still a place where the bugs can go in and live. Yeah? Secondly, you'll get an ugly stump with sprouts coming out on the side and all the other things. So the landscape is hurting by it. Woody debris removal in woodlots. Very interesting section. At a minimum, all woody debris, host material, greater than 1/2 inch, that under the canopy of the tree to be removed, must also be collected and chipped. So, even in the wooded areas, when you go in there and you find woody debris around the removed tree or around the transportation track, they all have to clean it up. They did a stupid thing. Some of the guys threw some maple branches on a big heap of wood that was 4 or 5 of that tree from 4, 5, 6 years ago. And I put some maples on it. And then the ODA guy, after going through all this, and he came and inspected my property. And then we walked by and he said, what is about this wood hide here? Oh, he said, you know, it's all dead wood. He went closer and then pulled the brains out, a little stick around 1.5 inch diameter, around 4 feet long, was a maple. And it was just cut. Somebody had thrown it on. What happened? That whole hide had to be removed. Were 2 truckloads with dead wood for 1 piece of maple. Yeah? In the track, they found pieces of maple, 2 inches in diameter, and I think Bill has seen it, we found it, and we showed him, and they were shocked. Because what happens when they go with the skid steer over the track, and there is pieces of maple they have removed, they will ride it in the soil, it was so wet, and then we saw a piece sticking out, took it out. Guess what's in it? Exit holes and egg bursts. Yeah? It was a shock. So now they had to go around and remove anything that's on that track. So they really clean out the area. They have to do that. The reason that they have to cut tops, limbs, and then fell the tree is to avoid that all these limbs are scattering around, yeah, and you get control over the limbs, you get control over the top, and then you remove the trunk, yeah. That's the reason that's in the contract, is to avoid all this debris. So now they spend 2 days picking up debris in my wooded area and in my lawn. That's it. So, the message is this. If you haven't done it, make a survey. You can use the survey sheets, make notes, write it down, and then send it in and demand action.
Mr. Earls wanted to know what the county or the township stance is on the road damage that's being done.
The county and the village, they can send in the same claim. Because if they do road damage, the road has to be repaired. Has to be brought back to the original condition. Same, because the roads are in the village that the village has to maintain. If they do damage to them, the village can claim it. But they have to send in a claim. Young is not going to send that claim in for you. Sorry? You have to send it in to Young.
Probably depend which roads they are.
No.
Would probably depend which roads they are, if they're county roads or if they're township roads.
Yeah. If they are county roads, the county has to do that. And if they are village roads, the village has to do that. But they have to send in to Young and basically copy the outgroup. And if you don't hear any response from Young, then basically the action will be taken, and it can be legal action, that they are forced to do it.
I've been contacting Young since December when they were on our property.
Yes.
The damage that was done, and it's not been fixed. I fill out this form. And USDA even has copies of the photos that I took of damage on my property that I went down. Of course, they change every 30 days. He put it on a computer down there. I've got the CD. I have not gotten anybody's attention other than they are running scared from me. It's like, you deal with that crazy lady. They're even telling me now. I had that John Hernandez come to my place the other day because they have to grind some more stumps. Because originally at the creek they weren't going to grind stumps and wooded lots, and now they are. And he sat there and told me the USDA is going to take care of my property problems.
Basically, Jung is responsible. Now, USDA, and what I did, I basically went straight forward to USDA, and we did something awful for the USDA in America. I sent it to the highest level in the USDA with a whole list of violations for the contract. I can tell you, I sent it out one day. The next day, USA Amelia was with two people on my property. They walked it, and I showed them everything, and they were in shock. And since then, there is very swift action. So sometimes, if the USDA in Amelia doesn't respond, you go to higher up. And we can give you the names of the people to send it to. And I think Dirk can help you with that. What happens, Dirk, if you nobody responds?
Doug.
Yeah, Doug.
Nobody responds?
Yeah.
Step on their head.
Step on their head, yeah.
I'm Doug.
Yeah, Doug.
Nobody responds?
Yeah.
Step on their head.
Step on their head, yeah. You see, you can place phone calls and even they hang up to me.
Yeah, I mean, they're running from me. I mean, I can't get young. You know, I mean, they just
won't.
Yeah.
We call on a cell phone where there's a record of every call that we've called on.
Yeah.
Yeah. Calling doesn't help you.
No. Well,
what you have to do, put it in writing.
But it's like, okay, yeah.
You have to put it in writing.
I just got now, but it's like, I've been fighting
to a sentence. You see, right, do the surveying again. All of what left out and is not done, you write a report and go back and send it to Young. And send a copy to the USDA in the Amelia office, even if you deliver it by hand.
Have you had any oil on your property since I've been there?
Not on my property, but I know there are properties where there is oil. And basically, if the oil doesn't flow in a creek or in a waterway, it's up to you. But you can demand that they remove the soil that is polluted. It's damage.
I have horses. We have horses, and we're seeing in the line, the fence line, where they fork a bunch of trees out, we have oil sitting on top of the water that sits in the ditch lines.
Okay.
Which is not a good situation with animals.
No. And you can claim a damage on that, put it in writing, put it in a report, and demand correction.
You're going to do this all day tomorrow.
You know, write it up. Any verbal thing has no value. You can call them, and I called them, they hanged up on me, and they only did it once. I wrote a report, and I sent it to the man in the USDA APHIS that drafted the contract and asked the question, why do you have a contract? And nobody complies with it. I have a whole list and added a whole list of violations of the contract. I can tell you that thing went through the USDA in the top level. And my son posted on his website a little video, you will see a part of that, and that went viral through the USDA. And all supervisors now in this project have seen it, because the last time we had people on our property, and the foreman there, he said, yeah, he had seen it. And he started talking about it, but he didn't know that it came from our property. And so we had a little bit of fun about it.
How many people in here have damage on their property right now, left over from young people? Right. Anybody have anything in writing?
Yeah. Yeah, but now I got to make it more.
kind of a handshake and we'll get back to it.
Oh, from that?
That's where I'm at also. It's a handshake and, okay, we're going to get back to this when we can, when it dries out. Yeah, that may or may not happen, but I'm going to feel much more comfortable if I've got something in writing that I can stand on.
That's what I keep telling. Show me something in writing. Give me something saying, yes, I acknowledge you have this problem.
Wait a minute. Young is not going to give you that in writing. You have to do that.
What you don't understand is I still have a tall tree and I do have a rope. If I get on my property, I will hang you there until somebody higher up comes and lets you down.
Yeah.
That may give me some action.
Yeah.
I've been letting her handle it because I don't.
You see, when they started the restoration, I sent the guys on my property because I knew when they are gone and all the trees are taken, I have no defense anymore. The only thing I can do is hitting him with paper.
Well, so, what confused me on the contract is what I said. When they sit there and say when the project is complete. So I was trying to figure, what do they mean by project? Is my property a project, or do they mean the whole area, whatever they're done in 10 years or something?
Yeah. Now, basically what they simply do, if there is no written damage claim, and they do the restoration, and Young reports that the restoration is done, the project on your property is finished. You need to get a written damage claim.
Does anybody get anything written before they start? Like, I don't want this to happen, I want this.
That's what I did.
That's what you did.
Three pages.
And you made them sign it before they started on your property?
No. It was after they had finished removing trees.
All right. But you don't think it's a good...
Because there is no damage before they start.
Well,
we are talking.
I can put it in writing what I want them to do, though. If I don't want them on my driveway, can I put that in writing and make it?
Yes.
Kind of
yes. You can demand that they don't use your driveway.
Should I go as far as putting it in writing, though?
If you put it in writing, you have a much more powerful situation. That's the mistake I made. I made handshake agreements, and they violated left and right.
Yeah, well.
And the reason is this. Young contractor, the head contractor, is mainly some people out of an office. They subcontract the removal of trees to all type of subcontractors. The subcontractors, two of them that worked on my property are both fired. They are gone, let go. Yeah, they are out of it because they created so much damage. But Young has absolutely no control what his subcontractors are doing. So if you get it in writing before they start, that don't get on my driveway, don't get there for my leach lines, don't get there for that reason, they might decide to hand carry the trees off your property instead of using heavy vehicles. So that's what I advise. If you have certain critical areas, you better get it in writing to Young.
Or in addition to that, I'd add that you not only put it in writing, but email that writing. That way it creates a timestamp on it.
Yes.
Instead of just a paper copy. Paper copies are wonderful, but get that timestamp of using an email.
Yeah, email is a better way of doing it.
Did you outline where your septic was, or not that geothermal heating you pulled?
Yeah.
That's
a biggie.
That's a biggie.
Outline it where it is, and make sure.
Rope it off.
They rope it off, and sure, make sure they don't get there. It doesn't mean that the subcontractor might go there. And if he goes there, kick him off your property. You have a right to send him out and say, you are violating my demands that you don't go there. Yeah? So you have to be tough. Don't play the nice guy. I tried that and failed hopelessly.
I'm sorry I come in late, and I apologize if you already touched the subject, but the soil compaction is one of the most hidden problems 5-10 years down the road.
Yes.
Second subject is I witnessed today the tree fell the wrong way, and they notched the open mouth, but they didn't notch the back. And I'm talking the big trees, and they're crashing in and falling in any direction they fall, and they're hurting good trees, including oak trees.
That's what they say.
Yes.
That's whole trees.
Basically, you can demand, while they violated the contract, by not taking the canopy and... They put me in the dark. Not removing the canopy and do it the way the contract describes. And when they make this collateral damage that should not be made, you can demand a replacement of that tree. And you know, I told them my pine trees, they are 28 years old. And if they die, I demand that you replace them with the same size tree. $12,000 per tree. Yeah? Four of them. Were they rushing fast, I can tell you that. Yeah? So you have to be strong, and you don't have to be unpolite, but you have to be strong and stay on your points because you have a right. And they violated your right by taking this big tree down without doing the right order. If they would have done that, it would not have happened. Yeah? Okay? All that.
Awesome.
Let's hear it for Colin. You put a lot of work into this effort, believe me. And he's going to be available, as I said earlier. We're going to break it out into sessions. So you will, if you want to talk about the legal, you go to one table. If you want to continue to discuss it with Cor and Dirk up here in the front, you would come up here. Boy, this thing got louder, didn't it? I just want to mention one thing that Cor didn't mention. Kind of the strategy that we're using here is the USDA is leaning on the fact that it's cheaper to remove trees than it is to treat them. That's what they're claiming, it's cheaper. Now, we happen to have discovered that that's not true, but in order to try to defend that as best as we possibly can, it's extremely important, as I said from the very beginning, to document everything because we want these restoration costs to just keep climbing. We're gonna make it more expensive for them to remove trees than it is for them to treat it. Do you understand? And the way we're gonna do that is to hold them to their own contract, continue to document every single little piece of damage on your property, and make sure it gets repaired appropriately, okay? Yes?
I give you just by hearing all this and stuff across the street, you know where I live,
yes.
They did not pick up all that debris on her place, and we've got video and pictures of the flooding from all the rains that we've had since then.
Yeah.
Heaven only knows where those branches and everything else went down the creek and around and where they ended up.
In East Fork Lake, yeah.
I mean, you know, and it's not for anybody's fault, I mean, because it's how they...
Right. I'm hoping that Nancy didn't edit out of Dirk's video that you'll see one of Young's General Contracting guys taking a piece of, could very well easily be infested wood and throwing it into the creek down there at his place. Hopefully that's the one. I hope she didn't edit that out of there. Okay, so then what we'll do, let's go ahead. We've got maybe 10 minutes of the of Dirk's video documentation of the damage that they did on the Smith's property, and then we'll break it out into sessions, and you guys can go talk to the contribution people if you want, or come back up here and get one-on-one, or, you know, ask me about Beetle 101 if you want to hear that, okay? All right.
Before you finish, I start by promising that if anybody would find out what my accent was, that... Yeah! How do you know?
That was not fair. I don't know. That cost him $25, and I think that was cheating. How many of the rest of you would have known that Dirk was from the Netherlands? Boy, not me. Not me. Okay, are we ready then, Dirk?
Hello. The gentleman made one little mistake. It's not the Netherlands officially, it is the Kingdom of the Netherlands. That's close enough. All right, I think you're ready for the video.
This is a short video about Young's General Contractors. Here's the property before and after Young's General Contractors. Due to carelessness by Young's, we'd like to show you some of the damage that's done to some of our remaining trees.
The vine. Vine's gone on. Wait. Stop it. Stand up.
How did this happen? Watch and see.
You see, the left hand side is doing damage right now. Don't care what's going on. Typical of Young's. Here we go again.
The pathway being 14 feet wide and the skid steer being 6 feet wide, there are some simple solutions to this problem. As you can see, Young's doesn't take those simple solutions. Plenty of room for one vehicle. The contract states, work shall be performed with due care, taking precautions against injury to persons or animals, damage to property, and interference with vehicular or pedestrian traffic. We're losing all of our infested host trees due to ALB. Now, is Young's eradicating the ALB or spreading the ALB?
Okay. here's the loading place, and here's some contaminated brands that fell off, ready to go to Eastwork Lake with the next storm.
The contract also states that Young's must restore to the condition prior to the removal operation, and all these conditions are to be completed by the end of each day, not the end of a month.
It's today, President's Day, February 20th. As you can see, the container from Young's is still there.
Flush cut? 2 inches? I don't think so. And as for grinding of stumps, they also have to grind the surface of buttress roots to a depth of 6 to 8 inches below the grade level. I have yet to see that done. General contractors had multiple violations of their contract as well as Ohio law. They acted in a reckless manner. They polluted our water, potentially spread the ALB, and acted in a rude and confrontational manner with inadequate planning and communication.
All right, very cool. Dirk, thank you. It seems extreme, but let me tell you, this video has made the USDA and the ODA and Young's General Contracting very, very nervous. So I don't know if we have to go to that extent to protect ourselves, but boy, if you're willing to do that, you sure have one in your pocket if you have something like this to back you up, believe me. Documentation, documentation, documentation. I can't stress to you all enough how important that is. What I'd like to do now is break it out into sessions. We're going to have Dirk and Core and Doug Simmons up here at the front table. We've got Danae and Thelma in the back for anybody that has any questions about how the contributions are handled to the defense fund. And then we're going to have Paul Barbic is going to be at the other table in the back to answer any questions about the environmental issues, about the environmental assessment that's soon to be released, we hope. And if anybody has any real basic questions about the Asian longhorn beetle, I will see if I can't help you through that as well. I appreciate y'all coming. If I don't get a chance to talk to you again before you leave, please show us your support. We're working real hard to save your healthy trees. Thanks, guys.